Heads, John Cola with GrowingYourGreens.com to have another exciting episode for you coming out here from my beautiful backyard garden here in end of July, almost August here. And we've been hitting 100 degrees basically every single day. This is like the 105 today, and later this week it's going to be like 110. So I'm totally used to growing in the heat as well as my plants. In any case, in this episode, I'm going to be answering your guys' questions in a Q&A session. I'm going to have two of these actually upcoming because I have so many questions that always get submitted to me and I have so little time to answer them. First, I want to apologize if you do leave a comment or just some random message over Instagram or Facebook. I apologize. I just will not respond. I have far too many people that follow me, over almost 750,000 followers now or subscribers on YouTube. And replying to comments and questions would be a full-time job, so I apologize. If you expect an answer from me and don't get one, please understand I'm quite busy in my life and I barely have enough time to get my food made, my gardening done, my business done, and I can't even finish or fold my laundry. It's still sitting in a big basket near my bed, which I just basically pull clean clothes out of the clean laundry baskets instead of even putting them away. But if you do have a question, there is a way you can ask it to me. Put a link down below to my Fiverr campaign for just $5. I'll give you a call for 10 minutes plus a Fiverr service fee. And I'll answer your guys' questions to the best of my ability. Now, please be aware, I don't know the answer to every single gardening question in the world like some people may think. I know a lot, have a lot of experience, but I don't know everything. And I'm by no means a master gardener. And I never went to school for any gardening stuff. I've just learned by doing, learned by experience, and learned by visiting so many people that know so much more than I do. And any money that comes in through Fiverr, I don't cash out. It stays in the Fiverr community to help get my videos transcribed so that people that are hearing impaired or live in other countries that don't speak English can now have access to my videos either through spoken or written English in closed captioning or translated closed captioning into other languages. So thank you guys who have supported me in the Fiverr campaign. Now, if you do have a question you want to get answered in a video like this, please be sure to check the link down below for a link to my community tab where you can submit your question there. I do go through those try to do it monthly and pick out a bunch of questions to answer that I'm able. Now, please be aware, some things I just don't know, and if I don't know the answer, I'm not going to pick your question to answer it, and that's just how it is. All right, so today's questions, let's get started. First question is from Crystal Stars. How can I tell if my veggies are high in nutrients or not? I watched your video on the mitlighter method and decided to keep gardening naturally, but like the mitlighter method can produce, but they aren't sufficient in nutrients, so I'd like to know how I can tell. I'm in South Texas where it is very hot. Should I try to build something for shade for my plants to grow, or is it okay to allow straight full on sun? All right, Crystal Star, so you ask, how can you tell if your veggies are high in nutrients or not? So I guess it depends what nutrients are you asking about, right? There's like vitamins, minerals, phytochemicals, phytonutrients, trace minerals, all different kinds of things. So like there's no real one meter that's out right now that could give you a general idea of how, like, across the board nutritious it is, but the best one that's out right now that's inexpensive is called a Brix meter. I do have videos about that, B-R-I-X, so search my channel for Brix meter. You'll see videos where I test my produce with a Brix meter, and that's a general way to measure the total solids, or more importantly, sugars and minerals, some of total sugars and minerals and dissolved solids in the fruit or vegetable you're growing. And in general, the higher the Brix, the better the fruit or vegetable is. And that's just the simple method. I mean, you could send your leaves off to get, you know, tissue analysis done at a lab, or send it off for, you know, analysis of the antioxidants, which are probably one of the most important things to me, or some of the different phytonutrients and phytochemicals that are in there. In general, you know, the more stronger tasting your produce is, generally the more minerals it the more phytonutrients it has, generally the more salty or sweet it tastes, generally, but not always, generally the more minerals it has. And just make sure that you're putting the minerals and, more importantly, the biology in the soil, and that'll help ensure you have a higher nutrient density in it. Next question is, should you build something to shade my plants to grow, or is it okay to grow in full sun? So there's pros and cons. You know, half my garden is under reflective shade cloth and the other half is under full sun. And this gives me the benefit of both worlds, right? Some plants like to grow in some shade in the summers if it gets too hot where you are, especially the plants that are not used to the hot summers where you live. Other plants would just love full sun, you know, so half my garden is in full sun, including my tomatoes, my peppers, my eggplants, you know, my basils. But on this side of the yard, I have, you know, more plants that are temperamental, you know, that maybe you don't like as much sun, that get a little bit of the shade from my reflective shade cloth above. So it can be all right to grow in full sun depending on what you're growing, and more importantly, how much you're watering. If you're growing in full sun, it's hot and burning on the plants. You know, I tested my plants today with a meter, actually. It was kind of fun. It was a, you probably can't see it, it's these guys right here, water spinach over in that bed. And I tested, I did my infrared meter at the wall. The wall was 100 to 110 degrees is how much the concrete cement block wall was. Now, when I measured my plants, it was like 82 degrees, 81 degrees. Like, how could, and like, I could touch the leaves of my plant, and it was notably like, wow, this is cool. If I was really hot, I'd just put all these leaves all over me and cool down, because it's like 80 degrees, and I'm like 90 degrees, because we're supposed to be like 98.5. So like, why are my plants so, like, cold, right? It's because they do what's called transpiration. They pull up the cold water that I just had watered them through the drip system that comes on automatically. It pulls up the water through its leaves into its little plant bodies, and it cools itself down, and then it lets the moisture out of, like, water vapor, you know, like out of our breath. It like releases the water vapor out of its leaves to help cool itself down so that it doesn't overheat. Now, my water spinach is like this, but then I checked other plants nearby and they weren't 80 degrees. Some of them were 96 degrees, so I think every plant's a little bit different depending on their respiration rate and how they work. And I'm no scientist or expert on that, but I thought that was interesting, and I thought I'd share it. All right, next question is from Victoria Lauren Skusen. Any thoughts on swales or natural water retention? Yes, I think they're an excellent idea, provided that you have a climate that you can do that, and that it rains, and I think you should retain your water, you know, naturally. If it's legal to do so where you live, I know catching rainwater and swales and digging ponds may be illegal in some places, which I think is quite sad. But I think we should collect as much water and use it most efficiently in our landscapes whenever possible. You know, I still am the firm believer, aside from the contamination in the atmosphere, that rain is the best water for our plants, not anything out of a well, a spigot, a hose, or municipal water. Next question is from Dustin Wallace. Curating soil quality, natural growing soil for cheap. This is the hardest question I still think about every day. That's one of the most important topics. IMO, you do a very great show, very informative and detailed. So natural, growing natural soil for cheap. That's a good question. So, you know, many of the different soil yards that I visit, they're simply waste recyclers. They get one input in, they mix it a whole bunch, they let it compost and sit, and then they sell it for a bunch of money on the way out. I mean, some of my favorite places, like the place in Conroe, Texas, Nature's Way Resource, that makes the fungal dominated compost, literally they basically get paid for landscapers to drop off their, you know, tree shreddings and cut down trees and chip stuff and yard waste, and they basically take money on the input when they collect that materials. They sort the materials, they shred it up even further, they set it in piles, they compost it, and they sell it to you on the way out. So, I mean, that is truly how to build soil, is take a waste stream from other industries, whatever they that may be, whether it's from arborists, whether that's from leaves, you know, in the fall, when the leaves fall, collect them from all your neighbors, go around and collect it when people put their bags out, if that's not illegal to do where you live. You know, get different kind of brewery mash wastes, get different kind of coffee ground wastes, go around to different juice bars and get vegetable scrap wastes. You know, there's many different ways to produce compost. One of the best, I think, to add fertility is to do a slow composting method or fungal dominated composting method. The simple and easiest one is leaf mold compost, where you just basically let leaves rot down over the winter time, and you'll have a really rich fungally bacterially balanced compost for super cheap. Of course, if you live near the ocean, I would also collect seaweeds that can have other benefits aside from the trace minerals in there. So, you just got to kind of look in your general area and see what kind of waste streams you can divert and, turn into something good, like rock dust. That started out as a waste stream from the rock quarry industry that grinds up rocks into different sizes, and they have all this dust, which is literally a waste product, which in some places you might be able to get for free or cheap. And that could be added into compost, you could burn wood, get wood scraps from construction sites, turn that into biochar. So, all these things can be free or cheap or inexpensive. You just got to find the waste stream, and then actually you're doing the company that has that waste stream of service. Normally construction sites have to pay for a big dumpster to get all their wood, pieces hauled off to the dumps. You can take those for free. I'm sure they'd give it to you for free, then they don't have to pay the dump fees, and now you could turn it into biochar. So, there's many ways, and you could get worms to put in there. So after you're done making your compost, then feed your compost to the worms and make it even more nutritious by basically growing your own worms. You could probably find some to start, or you could buy some, and then they will multiply and make more. So there's many ways to do it, and I want you guys to be creative on some of the different resources you find in your local area. Near the wineries, a compost facility basically takes all the wine grape seeds and the skins, the pomace, after it's been crushed and the juice has been squeezed out, and they take that and compost it in a big method. Oh, and I wanted to mention, best composter for doing this is the Sue Johnson bioreactor that I'm aware of. And so you have to SUJOHNSON, search it on YouTube for a video. I haven't interviewed them yet, but it is on my list to do. Next question is from Danny D. What kind of juicer do you use? Do you cook any of your food? All right, Danny. So I use different juicers. Today I use the Green Star Pro juicer. I was using my turmeric and ginger shots and with lemon. And then I made a turmeric, ginger, lemon, carrot with pineapple juice. And then I did an apple jicama juice on the Green Star Pro juicer. That's the juicer I like for the most nutrition quality. The other juicer I normally use is an Omega VSJ vertical juicer as a first step. And then a second step, I usually press out the pulp with a pure juice press. And then do I cook any of my food? I prepare all my food, and generally I eat food in their most raw and natural state with the least amount of processing. The more processing you do, including cooking, can reduce some of the different antioxidants, some of the different nutrition, as well as create toxins in the food. So, I don't want to do that. Although there are a few things I do heat process, such as mushrooms. Mushrooms should be eaten cooked. I cook them for 15 minutes in a pressure cooker. And then the other thing that I cook, I started to cook lately, is beans. So I will basically cook beans for about an hour in the pressure cooker, then let them on a low heat setting for like about a half hour. And then I'll take those out and then I'll inoculate them and ferment them. And I'll have a video on this soon on my other YouTube channel. Next question is from Backyard Gardening. What, if anything, can you plant July here in Vegas? Well, it's July and I'm in Vegas and I'm still planting. I'm planting Malabar spinach and I'm planting the water spinach. So those are two things you can definitely plant. You could also plant basil, right? You could also plant peppers. I just planted peppers earlier this month, also eggplant earlier this month. But you gotta be mindful when you plant. Don't think, oh, I'm gonna go out and plant at noon. Don't plant your plants at noon in July, even if I say you can. That could be suicide for both you and your plants because it's quite hot. So I prefer to wait for the evening. So after the main heat of the day, at least wait till 4 or 5 at night. It starts to get cooler. Then plant your plants in there. And then even for the first couple of days, you might want to cover them with a shade cloth, to protect them if they're not used to getting full sun. Like if you're just making your own transplants from inside and you haven't hardened off your plants, that's a good way to kill them. Just put them out in 110 July Las Vegas weather overnight. You know, all the plants that I end up planting in my garden have been sitting outside. Sometimes they're in partial shade, sometimes they're in full sun, but when I plant them in, they've been used to the weather that they've been receiving every single day. And when they go in the garden, it's actually kind of a relief to them because now they're not in a pot and they have room to spread out. Plus I put a nice, you know, nutrient mix, including beneficial microbes and fungi in their planting holes. I think I have a video that I did last year planting in July. If I remember, I'll post a link down below to that video, what you can plant in July. Oh, and then let's not forget about like more wild food. So I went to the state like nursery at Tule Springs, and I went over there and I talked about a lot of the different more wild foods. And so those are the foods that would grow in the desert pretty much naturally. Those could be really easy to plant in July as well. All right, next question is from Domo. I bought a raised bed garden soil for my raised bed garden planter, but these plants aren't growing too well. I planted in May and the plants are just there, not dead, but not really growing fast. It has enough sunlight, so add food scraps to soil? I water it well and it drains, but I can't seem to figure out what's going on. I'm in Southern California. All right, Domo, so what kind of raised bed garden soil for your raised bed did you buy, right? A lot of raised bed garden soils, especially the bag soils from like a Home Depot or a Lowe's or even a Walmart, even some that I have used in the past, right? I've noticed, once again, the soil companies selling bag soils are basically recycling basically free or cheap input materials, turning them into something more, and then selling them out the other end. How fast their process works, like we could get things in our facility and, you know, 2 weeks ago, and then it's going out in a bag product. Well, you know, if something's coming in 2 weeks ago, they're bagging it up and it's going right out, it's not fully composted, it's not fully broken down, and it's not going to perform for you guys that well as a gardener. So people always, John, what's the best bag stuff? And it's really hard for me to tell you. I mean, I like the Dr. Earth stuff the best, but even then, you know, there's drawbacks to that. I would encourage you guys to actually, you know, find a local soil company that produces soil for landscapers. You know, most of the time landscapers don't buy bag soil products at Home Depot. They go to a big, you know, rock and soil yard to get their materials. And that's what I think you guys should do if you guys can do that as well. So, you know, my personal opinion is that in the raised bed mix, there's probably lots of like wood chips or woody material that's not fully broken down, and that can offset the nitrogen and that can hinder your plant growth a lot. And I don't know what was in the raised bed garden soil you bought, the percentages or whatever is in there, or what even it looks like. I can tell you that when I moved here to Las Vegas, I bought bag soil products. And compared to my California garden, which I actually got at a soil yard that makes compost, the stuff grew like garbage. Like it just didn't grow. Like, I mean, yeah, the climate here is a bit more extreme, but also the soil was exceptionally bad. And that did not help my overall gardening. You know, my garden to flourish. So what would I recommend if it's not really growing fast enough and has sunlight and you're getting enough water? Number one, I would not add food scraps to the soil. Food scraps, once again, will take time to break down and then provide nutrients for your plants, and you might even not have the microbiology in your soil to make the food scraps break down as fast as they could and then be absorbed as nutrients in your plants. So the simple thing I'd do is I'd recommend a product called Pure Protein. It's at boogiebrew.net/GYG. And then that should, you know, give a spike to your plants to help them kind of boost their growth and get settled in a little bit more. I'd also recommend Boogie Brew Compost Tea, brewing some compost tea in there as well. I mean, those are probably the two things I'd start off with. Maybe some kind of kelp, liquid kelp product, fertilizer product to foil or feed with as well. But maybe that might help you out a little bit. The other thing I'd work on is, like, you know, adding things to your current soil to improve it, because I think the problem is in the soil personally. But also it depends, like, did you buy plants? If you bought plants, were they too young or too old? Did you start them yourself? I mean, were they not healthy as children? If they're not healthy as children, they're not gonna be healthy as adults either. So there's a lot of factors. I can't say it's this, but more than likely, my personal opinion is that the bag soil product that you likely bought is the culprit. Next question is from the Oakley Star. I cannot find bele cuttings anywhere. Is there another name for it? Where can I find them? Are you selling them? Yeah, so bele. So that plant actually is right behind me right here. I call it bele. It's also called like Pacific spinach. I think it's also called a hibiscus manuhot. There's like, if you just Google Kiko's crump, I know that's one of the, you know, cultivated varieties. I think that's Kiko's crump, or we'll have Kiko's crump on the other side over there. But basically I'd recommend not even starting by cuttings. Cuttings could be quite hard. They could dry out in shipping. I do recommend rooted plants. I have had luck with Wellspring Gardens ordering from them in Florida. Let's see, this last year I bought like 6 plants and 2 of them didn't make it and the other 4 did. In the past I've bought a lot of plants from them and pretty much all of them has made it, but this year 2 of them for whatever reason did not make it. I guess I'm a bad plant daddy. All right, next question is from Erica Goss. If I can only get one fertilizer, what should I get and where? Oh my God. You know, like, it's like one of these questions, like if you live on a tropical island, like what one food would you live on for the rest of your life? I mean, I know there's foods I'd live on for the rest of my life, but if there's only one fertilizer, what would you use? It also depends on like, what are you growing? You know, are you growing hemp? You're growing cannabis? You're growing vegetables? You're growing lettuce? You're growing, you know, fruit trees? Like it's all very different and each plant kind of has different requirements. So what would I say? Oh my God. If I say you could only get one fertilizer, what would you get? Man, I'd get some good worm castings that are built upon a wide variety of nutrients, because the worm castings could already have things like rock dust added into it. Could also already have things like biochar added into it. It could also have a nice fungal dominated compost that it was started with. It could also have soil humates in there as well. So I'd probably get the OGS earthworm castings. That being said, you know, it's important to build your soil and not rely on any one fertilizer. And I think a wider spectrum approach and using many different fertilizers, because each fertilizer can add different nutrients to your soil that can be beneficial, unless you've done soil testing analysis and you know you're deficient in this or that, then you'd want to add this or that, and then actually that would be the best fertilizer for your needs. So it's hard to say, always use this one because it's always the best. That's kind of hard. You know, but I would always add earthworm castings, OGS earthworm castings, pretty much before anything else. I mean, rock dust is up there too, but I'd probably put some nice fungal castings before even my favored rock dust. Let's see, next question from Steve McCann. Can you eat young sweet potatoes, or do that need to grow their full cycle in the ground? All right, Steve. So you can eat young sweet potatoes at any age. They don't have to grow to full cycle. Although if you're trying to eat them young, they're definitely gonna taste different. They're not gonna be maybe as sweet, and they're also not gonna store as well. In addition, you can eat sweet potato greens, either raw or cooked, at any age. And actually, I prefer to eat the greens when they're younger. They're a little bit more tender. All right, Marine Lewis. I have a question. Is there a way to use cat poop as fertilizer? How can this be done in an NYC apartment? I compost everything, but what can I do with cat poop? Thanks so much for your time. All right, number one is I do not recommend using cat poop or other carnivorous animals, including dogs, if your dog is not vegan, poop in to grow human food. Like, it could cause contamination, it can cause health issues, it can cause and spread disease. So that's number one, okay? Number two, if you did want to do it, the way you would do it is you would use what's called a bokashi bucket. B-O-K-A-S-H-I, bokashi bucket. Then that's the first stage. So you'd have this bucket, basically has this rice bran composted stuff. It basically will ferment, for lack of a better word, the cat poop. Then that would then get put out into the garden, dig a hole and bury all that stuff. And I would put this near non-edible crops, like ornamental crops, or maybe even if I did have fruit trees, I'd feel free to put it under fruit trees, as long as they're not like in bloom and producing fruit at that time of year, and that the fruit's not gonna drop anywhere near it. And then that bokashi should be pretty much, if done properly, should be pretty safe. And then you put in the soil, and then basically the earthworms and bacteria do the second stage of the process to compost it fully, to make it bioavailable and return that to the soil. Next question is from D. Biotun. Hi John, just wondering how much percentage vermiculite does your soil contain, and you think I could damage soil life like earthworms? Sometimes I feel that despite high organic matter, the broken up vermiculite I applied 3 years ago might damage my worms. Population could be higher. Also, I feel the vermiculite makes my soil evaporate too fast. Love what you do. All right, so vermiculite, like if you look at traditional like Mel's mix, which is the raised bed mix that Mel Bartholi recommended for the square foot gardening method, it's 1/3 vermiculite. Now, the question is, did I use that much vermiculite in my soil? And you know, my first garden, California, I absolutely did not. I barely used any vermiculite because basically I just filled it with compost because that was the cheapest and I didn't really know much better. And it worked great, actually. But I would only say that that depends on your compost that you have. Second garden that I put in here, I added maybe a bag of vermiculite per some of the round raised beds that I have. And then I went out to the other side. I just bought a bunch of bags of vermiculite, but nowhere near the 1/3 percentage. You know, so I would say, I don't know how much percentage I have off the top of my head. And then the vermiculite is not something I continually re-amend or add because it kind of sticks around. I do add perlite because perlite is a little bit less expensive and I feel it's good for drainage. Plus, I kind of like the way perlite looks. So I do add that when I top off my raised bed. So I would say I have less than 10% of vermiculite. Now, my personal opinion is that the vermiculite, unless you have a super high concentration, you know, is not going to affect the earthworms. Neither are other things like diatomaceous earth, biochar, volcanic rocks, you know, in proper dilution ratios or proper concentrations, because there's so much other material in the soil that it's not going to be harmful. Like, you know, there's like magicians and people that like walk over broken glass that people would think is really dangerous. But if you get enough surface area, right, to your foot when you're walking, I mean, I walked across burning hot fire coals at a Tony Robbins event. I didn't get burnt. I mean, that was scary as heck. So I think that worms could be fine. I think an issue with maybe not enough soil life and earthworms in your garden, you know, I've noticed that too in my hot, dry climate. If you're not mulching, you're going to have less earthworms if you don't have a good moisture level in your soil. And so that I would start there with that. Then the other thing is provide food for your earthworms. Like some of the very amendments that I put in, like shrimp and crab meal. I don't add those in any large amounts, but they're in some of the different fertilizer products that I use, right? Worms go crazy for that. Worms could go crazy for like burying like things like watermelon rind in there in your soil. All right, so hope that helps you out there. Next question is from Tommy Four Fingers. I live in good old Texas. It gets hot, like miserably hot. We should probably be considered just pure desert with lots of creeks. Haha. I've tried growing straight outdoor gardening and pests and fire ants just take over everything. The past 2 years I've had a greenhouse, but it gets 120 plus with shade cloth over the entire top. I get heat spots or burnout from it. I grow mostly tomatoes, cucumber, squash, and some herbs and lettuce greens. What would be your advice to beat the bugs and the heat? And would you continue a greenhouse in Texas or work in the ground? It's mostly red clay where I live, but I have dug a few feet down and added compost for my quail and chickens. Local mulch from the utility guys cutting down trees and DE with natural fertilizers along with good soil bacteria. I'm a low to zero till garden once I complete my original dig out of the hard clay. All right, Tommy, so you have lots of questions in there. So number one is in hot Texas, I wouldn't be growing in a greenhouse in the summertime. You know what? It's just gonna be too much work to keep it cool. I mean, greenhouses are great for temperate climates that don't get super hot. But in the summertime, like my greenhouses here fry unless I like roll the sides up, and they're in a covered overhang actually. So I wouldn't even recommend that. It's good for the wintertime though. So you could keep it up, grow in the wintertime when it would get too cold outside and it's going to be your best friend. But trying to fight the heat in the summer, I mean, unless you have like, you want to pay for air conditioning or get some kind of major swamp coolers to keep it cool, you're just fighting an uphill battle, and it's not worth it, in my opinion, for the effort and expense, utilities that you may have to put into it to grow. So my choice would be to grow outdoors. I don't know what part of Texas you're in, but I have had some experience setting up gardens in Texas for my ex-girlfriend's parents. And what I'll say is this: you want to grow things that the bugs in Texas don't like. So if you check my links down below, I have a video gardening in Houston, Texas, and whatever I grew in Houston should do fine wherever you are in Texas if it's hot and humid. And some of the tropical vegetables do really well, you know, including the longevity spinach, which is behind me, you know, including like a moringa tree that comes back every year in my ex-girlfriend's parents' backyard, including the Egyptian spinach that just grows basically from seed on its own, and they have so much, it's insane, including the Malabar spinach that would come back and just grow beautifully, including the katuk also, and also some other plants which I have back here, which I don't remember the name, it's from an Asian nursery there in Houston. But I'll put a link down below to that Asian nursery too. So go there and pick up some plants of the ones I recommend, and they should do good for you. You know, don't fight the bugs with trying to grow lettuce and things that the bugs like. I would grow things outdoors and find things the bugs don't like. Build some raised beds, build in some soil. You don't have to till it, and you should be good to go. If you live near Houston, I would go out to Nature's Way Resource to get some good fungal dominated soil. That's very important no matter where you live. Let's see here. So beat the bugs and the heat. I mean, for the bugs, the higher quality the food and fertilizers and nutrients you could add to the soil, the more resilient your plants will be. Like here in times of COVID, for people that are eating junk food, processed food, and are overweight, those kinds of people generally have a higher chance of getting the COVID and potentially losing their life because of their specific diet that they're eating. You know, certain ethnic peoples of certain categories, I will not generalize any particular one, you know, if you eat processed and junk food, right, you could be more applicable to getting different diseases because your immune system is not working properly. Likewise, you know, if you're feeding your plants Miracle-Gro and have high nitrogen, you know, some bugs may be attracted to your plants because they're not well balanced. So my goal is to have healthy plants by adding in nutrients into the soil, including trace minerals and, more importantly, the fungi and the microbes in the soil to give the plants everything it needs that build up a strong immune system and make these secondary plant metabolites and kind of play a role in defending, allowing the plant to defend itself from the bugs so that we don't have to get involved. Of course, squash bugs, I mean, I don't think you can grow a plant healthy enough that won't get eaten by squash bugs. So I want somebody to prove me wrong on that one. But luckily here, I don't have squash bugs. So next question is from Rolando Ramirez. The jalapenos I planted are sweet and have no spice, but I've planted cayenne, black cobra, and Anaheim chilies that all have reached peak spicy. Why not my jalapenos? That's a good question, Rolando. So basically, here's the thing. You probably got some seeds of some fooled you jalapenos or some sweet jalapenos, or somehow the sweet jalapeno seeds got mixed in with yours. Actually, and I would prefer, I love sweet jalapenos, and this year I couldn't find any, so I planted regular jalapenos, which I'm fine with. But actually, I like the no heat jalapenos. They're called fooled you jalapenos is one of the names, and actually I prefer those a lot. So that's probably what happened. Generally, cross-pollination will not affect this year's fruits, although it may affect next year. So for example, if you planted jalapenos last year and they're spicy, but you planted them next to a bell pepper that were not spicy, if the bell pepper pollen got over the jalapenos and they got pollinated, your jalapenos from last year would be spicy, but then if you saved your seeds and used those same seeds this year, they might not be spicy because they crossed with a sweet pepper last year. Of course, I kind of prefer that myself, but you may not want to. So, you know, maybe get some better plants from a better source or get some better seeds for next year. And meanwhile, you could send me all your sweet jalapeno seeds or seedlings. I'll gladly plant them in my garden, all right? Next question is from Back Porch Blessings, home, garden, and homestead. The first video of yours that I ever saw was to pollinate squash and zucchini. It was so funny and informative. I do have a question. We want to grow tomatillos, ground cherries, but we do not know much about them. We are in South Georgia, North Florida, And down here we have what's commonly called Japanese lanterns. They have a husk fruit that looks like tomatillos, but down here they are believed to be weeds. Internet searches have not provided me with suitable answers. I hope that you will address this for me. Thank you so much. All right, so the Japanese lanterns are kind of related to, but not identical to, the tomatillos and ground cherries, right? So don't just try to eat the Japanese lanterns. They're non-edible and maybe poisonous, right? I do encourage you guys to source good seeds, and actually I prefer ground cherries myself. They are way sweet and way delicious. And even some of the tomatillos, you know, when picked fully ripe, they could be amazing, like some purple tomatillos picked fully ripe. So I would encourage you guys to buy seeds and get seeds for these and plant them and grow them out. You know, a good source of seeds is rareseeds.com or Baker Creek Seed Company. So if the Japanese lanterns grow well for you and tomatoes grow well for you, the tomatillos and the ground cherries should also grow well for you. And actually, one of the things I like about the ground cherries, you know, they are more easily perennialized than tomatoes or tomatillos. So I was able to keep the ground cherries or poha berries alive in my greenhouse basically year-round without heating in the wintertime. Because it doesn't, you know, get to freezing. Next question is from Buzzard's Cry. Chili peppers growing too slow. Why? In SoCal, California, it's so hot. All right, so why are chili peppers growing so slow? So slow compared to what? Tomatoes grow faster than peppers do. Peppers, especially when getting just established, when you put them in the ground and from a transplant, they could take some amount of time to start getting growing. But once they do, they'll be off and running to the races. Although they still won't grow as fast as my water spinach that grows even quicker. You know, so tomatoes on the, or peppers on the scope of things are a bit slower growing than some of the other plants they may be used to in your garden. So please be aware of that. The other thing is, you know, I'm not sure what kind of soil you have, what kind of fertilizers or not you're using. Take a look at the video I made a couple weeks ago down below. I'll put a link if I remember, you know, 10 tips to grow the most abundant peppers, you know. So I added things like compost tea to my soil to enliven the soil microbiology. I'm confident that played a part. I also to help pollination, I added leaf cutter bees, which were amazing. Oh my God, it's probably the best thing I did this year was add leaf cutter bees. My production was off the hook, combined with all the other different things I do in my garden. So I'd recommend, you know, checking out that video and implementing as many of those tips as you possibly can. Carlos Alvarez, me and a few other guys want to start our own CBD farm here in Texas. We have acres of land, machines, and the urge to start doing this business for the people in need of alternative medicines. Do you have any recommendations on where to find a legitimate seller that has high CBD seeds? Definitely enjoy the informational content. Your videos on the organic farming at the Colorado Hemp Institute was inspirational. All right, Carlos, there's a whole like bunch of different CBD hemp seed sellers. And number one, make sure you get hemp seed sellers because you might be buying CBD dominant like THC or cannabis strains, which may be illegal. Plus the CBD varieties you're getting, it's very important that they have basically zero or no THC if you're growing hemp, because then you'll have to basically throw away your entire crop if the levels are too high, or figure out how to deal with it so that you can sell it. So in a previous video, I'll post a link down below, I went to the Texas Hemp Convention and I recommended a seed seller in there. So check that video for that seed seller. There's a bunch of seed sellers at that event, but most of them was only selling like large quantity of seeds. And you know, I know most of my audience is maybe home gardeners. I want home gardeners to be able to have access to the different seeds they want without having to buy like a million seeds at a time, all right? But there were other seed sellers at that trade show, so I would encourage you to go to a hemp trade show in the future, because you will be able to meet up with people that are in that industry and be able to help you out more. Next question is from Be True. I started a pandemic garden in April and planted cabbage. It doesn't seem to be making a solid head. Instead, the plants are getting tall. Is that right? It doesn't seem right. Not like in all the videos. Please advise. All right, Be True. So if you started cabbage in April, and I don't know where you live in the country, You know, cabbage is a coal crop, and a coal crop likes the cold weather. So April doesn't seem to be, to me, for most parts of the country, to be growing cabbage so that it actually will make a nice head. If it's too hot for the cabbage, it'll start to bolt. It'll get actually nice and large. It'll grow tall, and it won't ever make a head. It'll just produce your leaves. But that's all right. You can eat the leaves just as you would the head cabbage. Although the head cabbages are nice because once you got a nice head of cabbage, you can store that easily for, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 months even in a cold fridge, you know, with proper environmental factors. Like, I saved some cabbage that I bought literally in February, and I just ate it like earlier this month in what we're here, July. So February, March, April, May, June, July. I saved it 5 months in my fridge. It's insane. You got to keep your fridge nice and cold and, you know, keep it in a bag to keep the moisture in and maybe cut off the outer leaves that go bad as they go bad so that it doesn't contaminate the inner leaves. And of course, growing nutrient dense crops helps too, because that will ensure the crops stay healthier, you know, don't go bad or expire as quickly. They have a longer shelf life. So yeah, so that's my answer. Try planting them in the fall once the weather cools down. Next question is from Brescal O'Frio. What greens can I sow in July that resist the heat and humidity of zone 9B south of Tampa on Florida's Gulf Coast? All right, no problem. So I've been to Tampa, and you want to visit a place in Fort Myers called Echo, or another one I visited, I forget the name of them, but if I remember, I'll put the links down below to the videos I made at their facilities. They sell plants that will grow and, you know, grow in July. I would probably say if you want to sow seeds, you know, I would say things like Egyptian spinach, Malabar spinach. I would say if you can get water spinach seeds, I think actually in Florida, water spinach is actually illegal to grow because it's an invasive weed. I start by cuttings myself, and it is legal to grow where I grow here. Things like the longevity spinach right behind me would do great. Okinawan spinach, make sure that one's in the shade. Also, I would get these guys right here, bele or Pacific spinach, ahubiscus manuhat, talked about that a little bit earlier. Wellspring Gardens is a source for that. You really want to look for alternative greens, and these are the very greens that I would grow in my summers when it's 100 plus degrees here in the desert over the summer, and these are the greens that really grow great. Also, I love basil, and let's not forget about katuk. All right, so hope that helps you out there. Another page of questions here. Gavis Cisneros. Hey John, I was curious if you're going to make your achataba and achucha seeds available again. I would love to purchase some from you. Also, amazing work, man. I've been watching your videos since 2013. I'm really glad and proud how far you've come. I love the content and the in-depth information you share. I can also say that you have been an inspiration in my life. Keep up the awesome work, and I appreciate you. All right, Gaviz, thank you so much. So here's the situation with my achataba and achucha seeds and why I'm not currently selling seeds actually anymore. So here's the situation. So the situation is this. The situation was, I don't have time in my life to sell seeds anymore. Like, that's, I can't do it. That's one of the things that I love to do when I had more free time, but I'm so busy editing, uploading videos, making my own food, running my garden, running my business, and just trying to get my house chores done. Go out shopping once a week. And I mean, it's just me. I don't have a girlfriend, I have a boyfriend. Yeah, well, I like girls personally, but I don't have a friend to help me out. I just have me to do it, and so I'm overwhelmed. And so what used to happen is when I did have a girlfriend, one of the endeavors that I gave her to do to kind of create an income for herself was to sell my seeds. So I would collect the seeds most of the time. Sometimes I'd have her collect the seeds, sort them, sift them, and package them, and then she could sell them. And then I'd let her keep all the money. To me, it's not about the money. To me, it's about giving her an opportunity to make some money because she did need to create some income. So I was happy about that. And number two, more importantly, it was about me getting these special rare seeds out to people so that you guys could grow them and that these seed genetics do not go extinct, like many animals and even plants are in this day and age of big companies like Monsanto trying to control the seed supply and make this one stupid tomato that's pink and bounces the dominant tomato that everybody gets to eat, and we lose all these cool heirloom tomatoes or heirloom plants, or more importantly, wild foods and plants that really grow well that have some medicinal benefits, right? And that's why I sold the seeds. I mean, to help her out, to get her established, to, you know, give her something to do, make some income, also so she could travel with me. Unfortunately, me and the girlfriend didn't work out, and at present time, she's still selling some of my seeds, even though we're broken up and all this stuff. But basically, I haven't replenished her, so she has whatever seeds she's selling through. Whenever she sells through them, basically, she's not going to sell them anymore. And I'm kind of have some, I have collections of seeds that I'm kind of saving, holding back to maybe when I have a new girlfriend that wants to take up that position, or I find another alternative to make the seeds available for you guys without having me do it, because I don't have the time. Maybe I get an assistant one of these days. Maybe I get another, you know, girlfriend that wants to take on that task to create an income and have fun shipping seeds. But I just can't do that. So that's where I'm at right now. And so I do have Ashitaba seeds, personally, that I've in storage. And then my achicha, I've actually had crop failures on achicha, just due to many reasons. This year, actually, is because of COVID and not able to travel to grow my achichas like I normally do. All right. Next question is from Seed. Are your raised beds and containers overflowing from the compost and organic matter you add over the years? So it is not overflowing, because every year or every season I add compost on the top, but only to fill in the compost that was settled down or lost during the last growing season. So depending on where I am, depending on the container, depending on if the soil is covered or not, right? Depends on how much soil basically compresses down or gets used up by the soil microbes, bacteria, whatnot. And that dictates how much I add. So my containers are never overflowing. I do not recommend overflowing your containers, because when you go to water your containers that are overflowing with soil, the water just pours out the sides. So I always like to have a little brim of space that the water could go down. In addition to my raised beds, I always like to have it usually topped off. But then the soil always basically accepts the water and, you know, it runs down to water my plants. So that's very important to me. So no, it does not. And so no, you should not add extra soil. On some rare occasions, if the soil is getting a little bit old and it's not compressing down like it should, I'll basically scrape off a small layer off the top and, you know, then I'll replace it with some new stuff. But generally, I don't like to do that too much. I generally like to not mess with the soil once it's in place. Next question is from Auth. Thank you for being an excellent educator and an inspiring promoter of growing edible plants. Can you please do an update on your 4 Chilean wine palms that you had purchased in Fulton, California in 2012? Are they surviving? What condition are they in? Do you have them on irrigation? How drought tolerant have you found them to be? Are they tolerant of your climate? Are they in the ground or in pots? Do you fertilize them or mulch them? Are they showing a trunk? Have they flowered or fruited yet? The video, grow your own baby coconuts with a frost tolerant Chilean wine palm, dated 2 May 2012. Thanks, cheers. All right, Oz, so I would think that you probably are in the UK, because you said cheers and you said dated 2 May 2012, because in the, as Yanks over here, we don't usually say cheers and we don't put dates in that manner. So that being said, the Chilean wine palms are located in Northern California, really close to Fulton, California, where they were grown. And let's see, are they surviving? Yes, I believe they have all survived. I don't think I have lost one yet. What condition are they in? Depending on the plant. So some of them are actually on irrigation, and some of them only get watered when I'm in town, which is like once a month if it's not raining. So the ones that are on irrigation do a lot better because they're getting regular water and they're growing, and I probably need to up-pot them because they're in like 15-gallon pots and I haven't up-potted them in a while. They are getting bigger than how they used to be, for sure, and I definitely need to up-pot them. Do you have them on irrigation? Some of them on irrigation and some are not, and the ones on irrigation are doing a lot better than the ones that are not. How drought tolerant have you found them to be? Comparatively to other plants that I'm growing, I found them to be very drought tolerant. Not to say that you can't water them. Also, you know, California is more of like a humid climate, so that, I guess, things plays into an impact on how tolerant they are. Are they tolerant of your climate? Absolutely, yeah. Do not protect them. They stay out even in the winter time, and they've always been fine. And they're all in pots, 15-gallon pots. And do I fertilize them or mulch them? So they're basically just topped off with good my soil mixture when I top off my raised beds. When I have extra, I just kind of throw them around the sides. I do not mulch them. And for fertilizer, I may put some compost tea on them, or if I'm just mixing a batch of fertilizer that I'm spreading in my garden, I'll just put a few on the trees as well. But basically, I kind of ignore them for the most part. They're really low maintenance from my experience. Are they showing a trunk? Well, I mean, the palms are kind of getting a little bit bigger. I'm still seeing where the palm leaves are coming out. I'm not seeing like a trunk area yet. Although, you know, I haven't been focusing on trying to grow them for maximum production. I've just basically been focusing on keeping them alive. And I probably need to pay some more attention to them. And they have not flowered or fruited yet. I believe it can take many years for them to flower and fruit. All right, so I hope that answers your question. Marcus Love, how frequent and favorite way to fertilize your container plants? So I have lots of container plants. I have like all these 5-gallon plants like lined up the side of my yard, as well as a bunch of 15 gallons of fruit trees, figs, on the other side of my yard. And let's see, I fertilize them as when I remember. So generally when I'm fertilizing my garden, I've been using a liquid fertilizer. I'll put a link down below if I remember that video, where I basically use like Dr. Earth's fertilizer mixed with some other things, and I just spray it in the warm season, like maybe every other week usually. Also, when I have compost tea, I'll usually hit them with compost tea. Usually that's at the beginning of the season before it gets like super hot. And then also I will top them off when I'm making a raised bed mix to top off my raised beds, and I have extra. I'll go around to all my different trees and plants containers and add it to it. So one of the ways I like to use my spent compost tea bags, so once you're done growing compost tea, you have the whatever's left in the compost tea bag, I'll take a little bit of handful of that stuff, and that is super microbial rich. I'll just put a little handful around some of my potted plants to give them kind of an injection of beneficial microbes and organisms and trace minerals that's in that basically concentrated compost tea that's been brewing for 24 hours, but there's still good stuff in there. All right, so that's how that goes. And some of my plants, like my took plants in 5 gallons, they generally get a bit more fertilizer, meaning, you know, additional compost and or, you know, liquid fertilizer when I'm fertilizing areas of my garden when I have extra, because I like them so much. So I play favorites in my garden. So if you're a Katuk, you're going to get extra special treatment. Let's see here. Umbrella trellis. Have you put the web trellis to work in your garden? If so, how's it working for you? All right, so I was sent these umbrella trellises that look like these umbrellas without the umbrella top. And they were sent to me without instructions, but with all this PVC stuff. So I have not used them. I don't know how to use them. So I would encourage you to make a video on how to put it together with all the different parts, because I did not know how to use them. This year, I basically just planted all my peppers, which is what I was going to use one of those for. And I put all my peppers in, and I put individual stakes, which I prefer not to do. I'd rather just have your one umbrella trellis. It would cover the 4-foot mass, and it would guide everything up so that it wouldn't blow over. So I don't know. I haven't put them up yet. Let's see. Next question from Let Me Be Me. Having trouble with aphids, whiteflies, and caterpillars mostly, and I live in a dry, hot climate. My neem oil ready to use spray damaged my plants. I don't know what else to use. Any advice? All right. So different things for different pests. So aphid and whiteflies, you could use the same thing. So my first step for aphids and whiteflies is, number one, try to get your soil balanced first, then you're gonna have less issues with whiteflies and aphids from the get-go. Number two, make sure your plants are not stressed out. My plants that don't get enough water generally have more aphids and or whiteflies in a hot, dry climate. Let's see, after that, I would spray your plants with high pressure water, just using a standard hose, and spray off the aphids and whiteflies. Those will generally dislodge them and discombobulate them. That's probably the best way to do it. I also have used a high-pressure air gun. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to that video. But the water, I like the water better, although that the air gun could be nice and gimmicky if you got a little kid to do that for you. But it could take some time. And so then after that, the least toxic spray is called Dr. Zymes. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to the video in the description. That's my favorite because it's a non-systemic, pesticide that actually does work on aphids. In the video, I show how it worked on aphids. Just 24 hours later, there's a significant reduction in aphids on the plants I sprayed. And then for neem, I don't know why that's burning your plants. You got to properly dilute the neem with Dr. Brogner's Salsuds. I think it's like 2 tablespoons per gallon. If you're using more, then yes, anything could burn your plants for sure. And then caterpillars, I would recommend picking them off. Number one, if you're not able to pick them off, then I would recommend a product called BT. Just search for organic BT. And that's basically a bacteria that will basically blow their stomach open. Now, you know, I heard that that might not be the best for us to ingest, so I only recommend using that in isolated spraying areas. Despite it being organic, it might not be good for us because it might be a bacteria that might be not good for us to eat. So if you are spraying that on your plants, spray it on your plants, let it take effect, let it work, and then I would basically spray them all down and make sure any produce that you use from those beds that you sprayed that get well washed, you're going to have really low, if any, residuals on the plants that you end up eating that you sprayed. Okay. Next question from No Sellout. When building a veganic soil using Mel's Mix as a guide, what are the most important nutrition components and trace minerals to remember? I'm planting in raised beds and don't use bottled fertilizers and no chemicals throughout the grow seasons. More teas, top dressings with EWC. Thanks for all the inspirational and good vibes. All right, so veganic soil. So Mel's Mix is basically 1/3 vermiculite, 1/3 coconut coir or peat moss, and 1/3 compost. So to me, you know, that is a soil mixture that is prime for liquid nutrients, but you don't want to do that. So I think the most important components that are not in Mel's Mix that you should be adding to Mel's Mix are, number one, rock dust. Very important, wide spectrum rock dust, several different types. If you guys could find several different types in your area. Number two, high quality worm castings. Not all worm castings are created equal. OGS worm castings and Worm Gold Plus, as well as the ones I found in Texas one time when I made a video there, are my favorite ones that I found to date. I think that'd be also very important. You want to get a wide spectrum of different nutrients in your soil. So maybe some alfalfa meal as well. And I would also add in soil humates. You could get the granular kind. Also, I would use kelp and seaweeds, also green sand. So number one, we got the microbes in there. We got some of the soil humates. I'd put in the biochar that's been pre-inoculated or pre-activated, whatever you want to call it. I think that's also very important. We want to establish good microbial homes and good microbes in the soil. A fungal dominated compost is critical for optimal success, whether you want to create yourself by letting wood chips break down for a couple 3 years, or you want to bring some in. I think that's also a very important, to veganic gardening. So hope that helps you out there. And then, check out Down to Earth's vegan fertilizer, which I have a bunch and I'm still using to this date to add to things. That can give you a nice, well-rounded mix. But then even in addition to that, I add other stuff that I think is critical. Also, insect frass, very critical. They got the black frass, they got the mealworm frass, and they even got millipede frass. So I think frass is also very important. I personally believe those to be veganic, personally, because they're not coming from slaughterhouse farms, and manures, other manures. Next question is from Pissant Bugs. You are awesome. Any advice on growing shiso? So yes, I grow shiso every year, and basically, I don't even lift a finger to do it because the shiso, and I have the Briton shiso, basically goes to seed every year. They drop seeds and then they come up in the right season at the right time in my garden. Right now I have a bunch of shiso growing that I did not plant. So, it loves the climate here. If your climate is good for growing basil, you should be able to grow shiso without any issues. I like the Briton shiso. That's been the one that's most prolific for me, although I prefer growing the all-purple shiso myself. But that one is not quite as hardy as the Briton shiso, which is the green on the top, and then on the bottom of the leaves, it's purple. So, and I like the flavor of that as well, and they have nice large leaves. So if you were using them for Asian culinary uses, it'd be perfect. And actually, one of the hydroponic or aquaponic farms, they sell like shiso leaves for 30 cents each or something crazy. So it's like, man, I got a lot of money right here in my shiso leaves. Yeah, but it likes the heat, so don't plant them too early if you live in a cooler climate. I mean, here in the desert, you know, they just germinated at the right time, and right now my plants are about, the ones that I could see, probably about 2 feet high. I have some that are already 3 feet high, and they're just kicking some butt. Yeah, and I'd say proper watering. Like, I would go with watering them on the dry side. Don't keep them moist all the time. Don't keep them too wet. But don't let them dry out all the time either. But they're pretty tolerant. You know, they're kind of like weeds, in my opinion. Prepper Mama. Hi, John. Does using a watered-down Castile soap spray harm my plants? And does it really work to keep pests away without using harsh chemicals? All right, so I think everything can have a potential to harm your plants, and I guess it depends on what do you consider harming your plants, right? I mean, soap and oils might clog different stomatas and all these things, and I'm not a plant scientist to know all these things. But, you know, here's the thing. Spraying water on your plants, unless your water has, like, excessive chloramine or other kind of contaminants that are man-made, probably not going to harm your plants, and you could spray off many soft-bodied insects with high-pressure water. And I would do that first before I put Castile soap on. Before I even put Castile soap on, I would use something like Dr. Zymes, although Castile soap is a lot less expensive because that's a non-persistent and that's also guaranteed organic and proven to work. Castile soap can definitely clog up insects' breathing apparatus and make them not be able to move and all these things, so that may work as well. You know, in the spectrum of things, we want to try to do like the least amount of harm or damage to our plants, number one, but more importantly, number two, residuals to other beneficial insects that are going to be in your garden. And that's why I like the Dr. Zymes product, because after it basically gets too hot or it evaporates, it's pretty much not going to be active anymore in Castile. So I'm using like, you know, gray water system right now for washing in my outdoor kitchen. And it's been kind of difficult to find the right soap to use that's going to break down, that I could just basically freely dump my plants. So like Dr. Bronner's Castile soap said it would break down, but then that doesn't get my dishes clean. But yeah, so I would be cautious, but I think that yes, that can be helpful. And I always teach you guys good, better, best. You know, try to spray water first because that's less harm than spray maybe Dr. Zymes and spray Castile soap. And you know, if I'm going to be spraying something, you know, I'm breaking out the big guns. In general, I've been spraying like, you know, properly diluted Dr. Bronner's salsuds with neem oil, and I even added some spinosad in it because I was having these stupid ass bagrata bugs, and finally I found something that killed them. And I was quite happy about that. But even then, you know, I don't like to spray anything because it's going to harm the beneficial insects, because I know I sprayed, you know, with probably some ladybugs or whatever else that were on there at the time. All right, our next question from White Tuberose. Question: desert mulching to rehab soil, just a thick layer of wood chips for 6 to 12 months, or lasagna method with cardboard manure and then wood chips? I'm in Scottsdale, Arizona. So that's a good question. You know, I haven't seen any studies or, you know, science on doing the different types of mulches. I mean, here's the thing. Each type of mulching has different pros and cons, and each one of them will give you a different result, and the different result may be better or worse for certain things, you know. So, I mean, doing more of a lasagna method with cardboard manure and then wood chips, in my personal opinion, would make, you know, more of a bacterial fungal, you know, result, whereas mulching with just wood chips would make more of a fungal result. And this is provided in Scottsdale that you are watering properly, you have enough monsoon water or water in your climate zone so that the wood chips don't sit there and not rot down at all. So that could be also a factor as well. So, you know, I mean, each method has its pros and cons. What I'd recommend is try each of both and make a video sharing what you're doing and share your results over a couple of years so we could see what happens. I mean, if it was me, I mean, I would do whatever's easiest, what you could get the materials for, and obviously wood chips are a lot easier to get materials for than laying down cardboard manure and wood chips, but the lasagna method may be beneficial if you're trying to smother out weeds, because you're putting down a couple layers of cardboard first before you're just putting the mulch on top, which the things could grow up through the mulch, which things are a lot less likely to go up the cardboard. And there's just different options. That being said, I'd also, for you, look into the Johnson Tsu bioreactor for creating some of the best compost out there. Next question is from Sheila Attaway. I'm looking for organic fungal fertilizer In your past videos, you mentioned California humus. I can't seem to find that anywhere online or in store. Do you have any alternative or know of any site that carries it? All right, so California humus used to be sold by a company that I don't know if they're in business anymore because my local store in Santa Rosa closed down. So I think another company, Vital Landscaping, so it's vitallandscaping.com, I believe. They picked up California humus and are now selling that. It can be very expensive to ship out. So I did have a more recent video where I talked about Alaskan humus or Alaskan forest humus. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to that video, and that should be available at most hydroponic stores. And so that's a humus in a fungal dominated compost that I like that is available for most people. Jerry Girl asked, have any tips for growing and using aloe? So using aloe, I would recommend, you know, using it edibly and topically. Make sure you peel it properly first. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to the video where I made showing how to properly get rid of the toxins in the aloe before consumption. And then for growing aloe, like all my aloe is in my greenhouse, so it's protected from full sun, which is good and bad, because then when I did try to take some of my plants that are not used to full sun out in the full sun, they totally got burned, and they totally had to be, I should have hardened them off, which I didn't. I just put them straight in full sun. They could take it, but they had a hard time. I think I might have lost a few of them, but a lot of them finally hardened themselves off naturally. So I would say if you're going to grow them in full sun, grow in full sun. If you're going to grow them in the shade, harden them off slowly, or they will turn like a funny color, like they're almost going to not make it. And then they'll slowly come back from the center outward. I do recommend, having a well-draining soil for them, adding proper soil nutrition as well, and not watering them too much, but providing them enough water, right? Let's see. Emmett A, hello, I'm trying to grow veggies and fruit trees in the desert. Any advice would be great, like what to grow that is very good for dry, extreme hot and cold temperatures, soil amenities, drought tolerant, etc. Thanks for all the videos. So all right, Emmett, so I would recommend checking some of my past videos. I grow in the desert. And number one is, for fruit trees, you want to grow the easiest fruit trees. So date palms, super easy. Pomegranates, super easy. Jujubes, super easy. Start with those first. Those are the ones that are almost guaranteed producers. And if you can't get those to grow properly, then I wouldn't even move on to harder ones. The next ones, and I don't know what desert you're in. I'm figuring you're in one of the Arizona or Nevada or California deserts, probably. I would say like apricots generally do a lot better because they generally fruit before it gets super hot anyways. And so those are the fruit trees. And then for the vegetables, it depends on the specific season. So what I'd recommend is watch my videos where I do a winter garden tour and a summer garden tour and plant those crops at that time, because it's like hard to have one crop that does good all year round, although I do have a few of them. Tree collards generally do well year round, provided you could keep enough water on them and keep them happy during the summer, the hot summer. They love the winter time. My Egyptian walking onions, I always have a raised bed of those growing year round. They do great also all year. And then probably like these guys, probably the next best for me, although this is in a protected wall, so I don't know if you freeze in the desert you're at, but this one doesn't like below 33 degrees, but at 33 it's fine, whereas some of my other tropical plants will not take it. So that's the conundrum for the desert. In the hot summers, you need to grow a certain select variety of plants, and I grow generally more Asian greens, like the water spinach, like the Egyptian spinach, like the Malabar spinach. And in the winter time, you're going to want to grow more of the standard lettuces and kales and spinaches. So that's the biggest conundrum there you're going to have. And then the soil is just try to build the best soil you can. Soil amenities, of course, I just recommend the standard soil amenities to make your soil more resilient. Good quality worm castings, OGS worm castings, Worm Go Plus worm castings, available at Star Nursery if you're in Las Vegas. Rock dust. And make sure you do lots of inoculants of soil microbes, and more importantly, some of the fungal-based soils if you could get it. Next question is from Diana. Can you explain how to handle the little six packs of veggies like carrots that have multiple starch in each cell? Are we supposed to plant the whole thing or divide the plug up? All right, Diana, this is a question I've often had myself. And like, let's see, optimally, it'd be best to divide them up. So I recently got onions last season. And I was able to divide all the onions up because the roots were all conjoined and like got tangled up in one another. I was able to separate them out. And that honestly is the best thing to do. That being said, if you're buying them and they're already pretty much mature and the roots are already wrapping around and they're all in there, I mean, if you try to separate them, you're probably going to kill more plants than you're going to save. And then it might be good just to plant the whole thing. And planting the whole thing can give you mixed results because on many occasions, I'm too lazy to separate them out. I don't have the time or the patience to. I plant the whole thing and they don't perform well as they should have. I mean, on occasion, I get beets that do halfway decent if I'm not, you know, separating them out. Carrots generally, traditionally haven't done well. And if you're planting onions like that, I mean, you're gonna maybe get some green onions, but don't expect any nice onion bulbs, all right? So yeah, you should definitely try to buy them when they're younger. And honestly, on some of those things that you buy six packs of, those are the things that you should start from seed anyways, honestly. Next question is from Abel Borthwick. Hey bro, I met you at the Fruit Fest 2019 in Canada. My question is about peat moss. I'm using it as a top layer similar to adding wood chips. Do you know of any problems with using peat moss in a vegetable garden? So I would say I don't know any. I think the peat moss can affect your soil pH, but I probably wouldn't worry about that too much. You know, peat moss is not environmentally sustainable, although I believe that because you're in Canada, you have your own peat moss that you could harvest from, which then makes it much more sustainable. And I wish I had peat bogs or whatever that I could just, you know, basically collect peat from like you do. So yeah, I would not worry about that. Definitely important to mulch, and peat moss could make a valuable mulch. Let's see, next question is from XNoobXABotX. So my garden has been pretty damp and there is mushrooms growing in it, and I use a 1-to-1 ratio of hydrogen peroxide and water because I was noticing dampening mold. It's gone, but the mushrooms are still there, keep coming back. It doesn't seem like they're a problem, but I would like your opinion on it. Thank you for everything you do. If you don't get to this question, still looking forward to your next video. Have a good day. All right, so mushrooms, generally they're a sign of excess water because they're not going to grow where it's too dry. If it's too damp and you've had mold, then that's a sign that you're watering too much. You know, in the wintertime when it's just raining a lot here, I will get these funky-ass, kind of scary-looking mushrooms. I'm like, man, those look like aliens or something. But you know what? If they bother me a lot, I'll pull them up and just throw them in my compost. And usually they're just, I just kind of let them hang out there because you know what? I find the roots of my plants will grow into the mushroom globule in the bottom. And it looks like the roots are getting nutrients from the mushrooms. So, I mean, nature is an amazing, literally, web of life. So, I mean, I would say don't let the mushrooms bother you. I would not, by any means, harvest them and eat them unless you're a mushroom expert because they may be toxic. But I think they're definitely beneficial for your garden. I would leave them is my first choice. If they really look unsightly and you don't want them there, I'd basically put them up and put them in your compost. But mushrooms, to me, are actually a good sign. There's a sign of fertility, but also a sign of potential issues like you are overwatering. So maybe pull back on the watering a little bit, and if everything's in balance, you know, you won't get as much mushrooms, all right? Next question is from Wholesome Warrior. What is the best organic fertilizer to get rid of really strong, hardy dandelions? So I don't know if there's a fertilizer that'll get rid of dandelions. Fertilizers generally help things grow. I don't know if you're looking for some kind of pesticide or herbicide to get rid of your dandelions. You know, there are pre-emergent you know, pesticides that can be considered, or herbicides that can be considered organic, but basically to get rid of really strong dandelions, I mean, pull them up, man, pull them up by the roots. I mean, it's labor. I mean, this is the old-fashioned way of dealing with weeds. I mean, there's no quick solutions. You could try to burn them, but then you could also like burn your house down. There's different, you know, steamers that could steam weeds. I covered them at a trade show. There's like this weed thing that I covered at an agricultural conference, you know, that with a heat plate. I mean, I would say, but just the good old fashioned way of just pulling them up one by one. There are no shortcuts to organic gardening when you're using something like Roundup. You know, that's not good for the planet and not good for us based on recent lawsuits, in my opinion. All right, so last question is from Tina Lee. Do you have any suggestions for edible lawn, something that can be mowed, maintained like grass lawn, and looks manicured, but happens to also be edible? And to clarify, the mowing could be in the form of harvesting. Boyfriend wants a lawn, I want food, trying to compromise. All right, Tina, so lawns, you know, no matter the kind of grass, they're all edible, so you could have a lawn and you could eat it to when your boyfriend mowed it, you could juice it. And I don't know how else I would actually necessarily eat a lawn personally. you could grow like wheat. You could grow wheat seeds and have a wheat-based lawn instead of like the standard Bermuda grass or whatever grass are kind of growing for you. All the grass family, pretty much, as far as I'm aware, are completely edible. That being said, not super fun. So the question is, what alternative front yard materials could you use that could be edible? So, you know, that could be quite difficult, quite challenging, and more importantly, quite costly and expensive. You know, there's not really any good ground covers that I've seen. I know there's like this Corsican mint. Corsican mint is like a mint. When you step on it, it looks like, it smells like mint. And it's completely edible, but it's quite expensive. So you'd have to start off by just putting in small patches, and then basically it would expand over time. And then actually you would need very little maintenance, because it's, you almost really don't have to cut it back too much, but that's going to be quite expensive, because I looked into basically covering my ground with the Corsican mint at one point, and it was cost prohibitive. So, you know, I would do a compromise. I would, you know, let the boyfriend have part of a lawn and just try to carve out like small edges, you know, along the edges of a 4 foot wide raised bed to grow in a nice edge, you know, a nice long bed, whatever, 40 feet by 4 foot or even by 2 feet wide at the edges. So we could have his lawn in the middle, and then you could have the edges for maybe some nice, well-manicured raised bed gardens, because that's gonna be a lot more effective to grow food than trying to fit something in a lawn, which is like this whole idealistic model of what we should be doing instead of what we should actually be doing. You know, depending on where you live, you can maybe have sweet potato vines, and they may grow year-round depending on where you live, like South Florida. But if you live in most places, they could look good in the summertime, and then they're just gonna look like, you know, dirt in the wintertime. But in some places, like, it could just be a lush green all the way around, and they don't generally grow too high or too big, but still, that might look out of place depending on your neighborhood if they have HOA restrictions and all these different things. So yeah, I mean, I think my best bet is to compromise and let him have a big lawn and just take some small borders along the edges to have a nice long raised bed. Actually, my first garden was like that, where I just had a lawn. I paid $1,000 to put in a lawn. You know, little did I know how maybe not intelligent that was at the time, because I thought that's what I was supposed to have. And then I grew in the periphery until later I basically cut out the whole lawn. I just grew in the whole thing. So maybe if you just start by a small section, grow it really nice. He sees the benefits. He loves the food. He'll let you encroach more and more on his land and on his lawn, and you could grow more food, and he'll have to do less mowing and less labor, and you'll have more food to eat in the long run. But you gotta move them along slowly, much like I recommend for everybody starting a garden or even making dietary changes to eat more fresh fruits and vegetables that you guys are actually growing in your garden. So it's pretty much dark now. I gotta go inside and eat some food. I'm super hungry, and the video is probably getting quite grainy because it is quite dark. If you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else you might think it could help. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes. I come out every 5 to 7 days, you never know where I'll show up or be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. Make sure you click the links in the description for some of the videos that I've referenced in this episode. And make sure you check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,500 videos at this time on this YouTube channel, dedicated to teach you guys all about growing your own food at home so you could be super healthy and eat it too. All right. So with that, my name is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.